Charles Paris mystery, An Amateur Corpse, written by Jeremy Front, based on the novel by Simon Brett. Episode 1.
My tapeworm of an agent had dropped off the radar just as the recession bit, or in my case, sank its rabid teeth into the seat of my pants.
Did I hear coffee?
Yep, the deli guy's finest beans, freshly ground for your greater pleasure, madam.
The deli guy charges a fortune for coffee.
Some things are not worth economising on.
Just as well you've never developed a taste for single malt.
I'm sick of this walking thing, banging round the house like an invalid. Are we allowed to see invalid these days?
After a very minor toe operation, or as she put it, going under the knife, my mother had been staying with us.
I'll have a coffee, if it's on offer.
Okay.
To avoid stairs, she was sleeping on the sofa bed, so the sitting room was now a makeshift bedroom.
Did you see the documentary on fat kids last night?
They weren't fat, Joan. They were clinically obese.
Morbidly obese.
Either way, they weren't just fat.
Another perfectly decent word we're not allowed to use.
It's political correctness gone mad.
Charles.
Have you lost weight, Francis?
No.
Men don't like women to be all skin and bones, you know.
You needn't worry on my account. Right, I'd better get going.
You haven't had any breakfast.
I'll pick something up.
I'll make you something. Please don't leave me with her.
I do admire you.
Why?
Well, I wouldn't dare step outside without my slap on.
Okay, I really must go.
Joan had been with us nearly a month, and even the angelic Francis was showing signs of strain.
Why can I smell smoke?
Don't look at me. Even if I wanted to, I'm not allowed to, according to Dr. Death.
It's the arse, Joan. He doesn't like it when you call him Death. Oh, no. Charles.
Why me?
Actually, I can smell burning.
I'll have a look.
Oh, great. Now the fuses have blown!
Maybe it's terrorists.
Why would terrorists target my fuse box?
They like to undermine national morale.
The sofa bed's on fire. Give me the fire extinguisher. Phone 999.
You broke my wheel.
Look at the state of the super bed.
The bedding took the brunt. She left her wand under the duvet.
So she has been practicing the dark arts in here.
Her curling wand.
Where is she now?
Flirting with the fireman.
Look at the mess. And I'm late for work.
Well, it could have been.
Don't say worse. Don't you dare say worse.
They complimented me on my speedy extinguisher work.
Maybe you should chuck in acting and join the fire service.
What a gorgeous boy. Did you see those muscles, Francis?
I was more focused on the small conflagration in my sitting room.
Could have been worse.
So I've been told.
At least no one was hurt. I'll pay for any damage.
You sound just like your son.
What?
How about a nice cup of tea?
I'll put the...
It's all right, Charles, it's all right. I'm not completely incapable.
I know, it's not easy, but the dressing comes off on Friday, then she can go home.
Do you think?
Joan's as tough as old boots.
I'm not sure she's as tough as you, Nick.
She looks great for her age. You look great too, by the way. Never mind what she says about makeup. You've just got different tastes.
Forget makeup. What about the curling wand?
I suppose it might give your hair a bit more bounce.
Hair curling wand? The one that caught fire?
We all forget things. I do, all the time.
She left the bath running the other day. The door was open as I walked past, so I averted a flood.
Well, remember the time I flooded the house?
Yeah, but you've been irresponsible as long as I've known you.
Thanks for that.
Speaking of responsibility, I've got a PTA meeting tonight, so you're on cooking duty.
But I've got a thing.
Thing?
Like a work thing.
Like a work thing or an actual work thing?
A work thing.
A job?
Not a job.
A casting?
Not as such.
Oh, you're floundering, Charles. You haven't got a thing. You just want to get away from your mother.
She's bad for my self-esteem. She keeps asking about actors I was at drama school with and reminding me how successful they are.
You're a big boy now. Let it go.
She won't let me.
Well, I'm sorry, but you're still making dinner.
Pump.
Sorry?
What is your pump number?
No petrol, just 3 pasties.
Loyalty card?
No.
You get like a discount next time.
On pasties?
On petrol.
I don't need a discount on petrol, I haven't got a car.
All right, don't want your life story.
What charm school did they find you at?
Don't be aggressive, sir.
I'm passive, you're the aggressive one.
This petrol station operates a zero tolerance policy.
On politeness?
On like verbal and physical abuse of staff.
Just for the record, young lady.
Gender is irrelevant, so that's like sexist. which is like inappropriate language in the workplace, which is like violating my human rights.
I just want to pay for three pasties, which I notice are like made in Slough, not Cornwall. So, strictly speaking, they're like contravening the European Commission's legislation on protecting traditional speciality products.
Security to till number one, please.
Okay, keep your bloody pasties.
Would security come to till number one,
please? Don't bother, I'm out of here.
Oh! Charles Paris.
Hugo.
Unbelievable! Whoa. Synchronicity or what? I was talking about you last night. You in a rush?
See the bad-fitting uniform heading this way.
Big guy.
And I don't think he's been fed today.
Ooh, have you done a bad thing, Charlie?
No.
Red car's mine. I'll pay for my petrol and we'll get out of here. Just like the old days!
And it would have been, apart from Hugo's flash car and the sweet smell of excess oozing out of his leather upholstery.
I haven't been recumbent in a car for years.
Like it?
Strictly for the pre-osteoporosis generation. I'd have loved it when I was 25.
I couldn't afford it when I was 25.
Yeah, I can't afford it now.
Ah, the outlaws on the run again.
Oh, I don't run, I shuffle. Are you still acting?
Ah, jacked it in when I realised theatre was never going to keep me warm and fed.
You were smart to work it out early. So what do you do?
I run a voiceover company.
Really?
It's bought me the lifestyle, but I can't live in the moment like we used to.
Where are we going, Hugo?
Exactly what I keep asking myself.
No, I mean now. Where are we going now?
Oh, where do you want to go?
I promised Francis I'd cook dinner tonight.
Wow, you two still an item.
Semi-attached item. Where are we going, Hugo?
How about my place?
With an insouciant disregard for speed limits, Hugo tore through leafy avenues and out into the land of gated estates and country clubs, the natural habitat of the strictly come golfing set.
Wonder if Ellie's in.
What happened to Ginny?
Ah, predictably short story, full of the usual clichés.
Yeah, I've read that book.
Oh, you haven't got a monopoly on lack of commitment, Charlie.
At least yours has got a happy ending.
Oh, jury's out on that one. Ellie!
A plaintive melancholy in the voice and a sadness about the eyes told me that all was not well on planet Hugo.
Ellie! Oh, out yet again. Is it still scotch?
Well remembered. Nice place.
Ah, see what you make of this malt.
Wow, a 25-year-old. This is a long way from the squad.
Yeah. I'm your classic textbook sellout.
Well, whatever you sold, you must have got a good price for it.
Power to the people.
Up the revolution.
I envy you, Charles. You've got integrity.
I've also got holes in my socks. What buys you a place like this?
Bring your glass, I'll show you.
Through a kitchen the size of a restaurant, Hugo led me out into the garden. On the far side of the swimming pool was a smoked glass and steel cube.
Welcome to the shed at the bottom of the garden.
A soundproofed shed? Don't tell me it's just a music den.
A bona fide tax-deductible expense. Business is in Soho, this is so I can work from home. I call it my walk-in stereo. What do you want to hear?
Surprise me.
Yeah, there are a few malts in that cupboard. Choose one and top us both up.
In the drinker's chain of command, I rank equal with a field marshal, but this was early in the day, even for me.
The downside of living in a bourgeois hellhole is the neighbours. Yeah, oh, cheers. Upside is great contacts like the architect who designed this for me. He belongs to Ellie's drama group.
What, am-dram?
Ooh, don't let them hear you say that. No, as these things go, they're quite ambitious and experimental. Of course, Ellie's head and shoulders better than the others. She should be after 3 years at drama school. Do the honours.
I think I'll hold.
Ooh, I never drink alone.
For some of us, drinking's part of the daily commute. It gets us to work and sends us home to bed. Hugo was never like that. He boarded the train at Jovial Central, passed quickly through Self-Pity Junction, topped up at Belligerence Parkway before alighting at Misanthropic Temple Meads.
So you married an actress?
Yeah, she can't get arrested. You'll have loads in common.
My meteoric descent goes before me.
No. I meant you've been round the block a few times, so you might be able to cheer her up.
So she's new to the business?
I said my story's full of clichés.
Is this the time-honoured tale of the younger woman?
Honour doesn't come into it, and Ellie's not much older than your scotch.
The sports car, the funky haircut, the embarrassingly youthful clothes, it all suddenly made sense.
Well, you're in the business. Can't you get us some voice work?
Nepotism doesn't play well with the clients. Speaking of work, how are you fixed at the moment?
Golden rule of acting. No matter how broke or desperate, accentuate the positive. If there is no positive, lie.
Well, there have been a few availabilities recently, and I've got projects bubbling under, you know, like irons in fires.
Suppose you couldn't do something for me.
If you want a job doing, then ask a busy man. What is it?
It's just a test, so not for broadcast, but if the client buys it, big campaign.
I'm in.
You're not just saying that as an old mate?
Absolutely not.
I'll contact your agent.
You say it's not for broadcast?
At this stage.
We needn't bother, Morris.
Cool. Mm. Knock off that bottle, then we'll compare it to a Beaumont.
From Isla, we skipped across the water to Mull till the afternoon faded in a haze of smoky malt. So when Hugo insisted we adjourn to the theatre bar, I was beyond the rational state of resistance.
I'll get these.
No, absolutely not. My manner, my shout. Two very generous whiskies, please.
The bar was the altar of a desanctified church, the walls plastered with posters of past productions. In keeping with the ambitions of the resident company, the latest was Marat Sard.
Ah, Hugo. Where's the gorgeous Ellie? We're going to run some Lecoq warm-ups.
Did we do Lecoq warm-ups, or did we just act?
Sometimes not even that.
Clive didn't look old enough to be in a bar, and had that air of overconfidence prevalent amongst candidates on The Apprentice.
Are you in the play?
Could say. I'm Marat.
You should see the DVD of the Peter Brook 64 production.
Yeah, bladers. I don't want another actor's interpretation in my headspace. You should catch ours, though. We put the text aside, workshopped it, then sort of improv the arse off it. But hey, that's the job.
No, really? I thought your job was a primary school teacher. No, sorry. Classroom assistant.
If anyone needs me, I'm getting some air before the warm-up.
Idiot. Drink up, Charles, I'm parched!
But before I could bail out, there was another glass in my hand and a suburban bohemian bearing down on us with a wheezy little pug in tow.
Hello, here we go. Quiet, Cherry. As Hugo's clearly not going to introduce us, I'm Saskia.
Charles.
I said quiet.
Oh, she's a lively little thing.
It's a he. Short for Sheridan. The playwright?
Yes, I've heard of him.
He doesn't bite.
Well, he's been dead for 200 years.
The dog, silly. You're just being friendly, aren't you?
Yes,
you're just being friendly.
At that moment, he was being a bit too friendly with my left trouser leg.
Saskia's another local thess.
For my sins. I'm Rosignol, but we're all doubling and trebling like mad. Mad. It's set in an asylum.
Yes, I know.
He's an actor.
Are you?
Professional.
Oh, wonderful.
In real life, Saskia's our very own Orla Garin.
He means I'm a journalist.
Oh, have I read any of your work?
I'm mainly lifestyle and features.
No, she does hard news too. Tell him about your in-depth piece recently in the Observer handbag section.
We can't all be Polly Toynbee. I may not win the George Orwell Prize, but I get some very nice freebies.
I can vouch for that. When are you going to do another piece on Agent Provocateur?
Take a cold shower, mister. Have you met Charles?
I'm about to. Jeff Winter.
Charles Paris.
He's an actor.
The real thing? Yikes. You're not coming to see us, are you? He said nervously.
I'm sure it's a terrific production, but I'm not tonight, I'm afraid.
Phew. Jeff breathed a sigh of relief, wiped sweat from brow.
Are you the architect who designed Hugo's amazing studio?
It's not bad, if I say so myself. Blushes modestly.
If you like it, tell your friends.
Yes, I'm available for new builds, loft conversions, extensions large and small. No innuendo intended.
A man of many talents.
He won't say so himself, but my husband also makes a mean Marquis de Sade.
I think meanness goes with the territory. When I got the part, I thought it was going to be all Ken Russell, leather and whips.
Some hopes.
Too much information, Sam.
Poor Charles is thinking, what have I walked into here?
I wasn't. Trouble with am-drammers is they never stop acting what they imagine actors to be.
Oh, at last, the star of the show.
Don't be stupid, Hugo. I don't think Sherry likes me. Of course he does. Everyone loves Ellie.
No one does disdain like an older woman for young competition, and the look Saskia shot Ellie was similar to the one I gave her pug as it frotted my jeans.
Alf! Sherry, stop that!
I blame the master.
That's enough from you, madam.
Well, I'm off to get my sad rags on.
Yes? Love you and leave you.
If that woman's breathing, she's talking.
How much have you had?
Oh, nice greeting in front of my oldest, bestest friend in the whole world.
So you're Hugo's partner in crime from the good old days.
Well, more understudy.
And we're going to work together again. Go down, it's the office. Right, get him in, Ellie.
I don't want to be a party pooper, but I'm going to put the brakes on.
Oh, that's not the Charles Hugo described.
Even I ease up sometimes.
I wish he would. Do you grab a table?
Yeah. Classically pretty, with a face unetched by age or experience, I'd met countless Ellies in my time. They pour out of drama schools each summer, and unless this one had something exceptional, her career had stalled because the market was flooded with bright-eyed ingenues.
Hugo tells me you're an actor.
Exaggerating again.
You went to drama school.
Oh, lots of waitresses have been to drama school.
Well, you're not a waitress.
I know. I'm very lucky to have a wealthy husband and a lovely house in a desirable suburb, etc., etc.
Don't knock it till you've lived in some of the Hogarthian hovels I've had over the years.
I should be grateful. I just get a bit... I feel out of the loop.
Yeah, it's a bad climate at the moment, or so my agent says.
Your agent speaks to you?
Occasionally, intermittently. Okay, rarely. The thing is, ultimately this business comes down to natural selection.
Survival of the fittest.
Well, if that were true, I'd have been extinct 20 years ago. It's more survival of the bloody minded. Sorry. It's my mother. What's wrong?
Why should anything be wrong? You need to relax, Charles. Take up yoga.
Thanks for the advice.
Are you eating out tonight?
No, Francis has got a meeting, so I'm cooking.
Oh.
What's oh mean?
I haven't got much of an appetite since I went under the knife, so don't do anything special for me. I'm fine with a sardine or a poached egg, if I can get the hang of Francis's fancy hob.
I'm leaving now. Just wait until I get...
What's that?
My battery's going...
Don't waste it chatting.
You phoned me. Why don't you just put the telly on?
It's all cooking or tattooed yobs having sex with their in-laws. Don't worry about me. I'll be...
Oh, bloody battery.
Shall I make your excuses to Hugo?
Yeah, would you? I'll ring him tomorrow. And it was nice. It was good. I'll see you later.
Bye.
Gravity was up to her old trick, so I swayed to the bathroom and splashed cold water on my face. I was leaving by a side door when I found myself stuck between a fire exit and a fight.
Are you serious?
Dudley!
Have I been misreading signals or something?
What signals?
You're joking, right?
No, Clive, I'm not joking, and we've got a show to do, so why don't we just pretend this never happened?
You are something else.
Yes! A married woman.
No, don't give me that.
No, I'm not giving you anything.
It's not the impression I've been getting.
Then you've been getting the wrong impression.
Okay, I get the message.
I'm sorry if I said something
Just drop it, Ellie. I know when I've been strung along.
I was squeezed behind a door, so when a flustered Ellie came past, there was nowhere to run or hide.
Charles!
Sorry, I wasn't eavesdropping.
You heard that?
I couldn't very well avoid it.
Oh, Clive's an idiot.
I've kind of come to that conclusion.
I don't know what fantasy's been playing inside his head, but it's had no encouragement from me. You won't mention this...
Hugo doesn't need to know anything about it.
He can be very jealous.
It's forgotten.
Thanks. I can see why Hugo's so fond of you. Come on, I'll drop you at the station.
Are you sure you've got time?
Anything to get me out of Clive's Lecoq warm-up.
After an afternoon with Hugo, I was in no fit state to be let loose in a kitchen. So I invested money I was yet to earn at Mr. Poe's Mandarin Palace.
The hunter-gatherer returns bearing a special banquet for three persons with complimentary prawn crackers. 12 quid a head, but I'm back in work, so it's my... treat. Hello? Where is everyone?
Charles, your phone's off, so if and when you get this, I'm at the hospital with Joan.
Oh, I thought that was
nice. They're sedating her now in A&E.
Sedating?
Oh, I've got to switch this off again. Ask for us in A&E.
What happened?
At last.
Where have you been?
Working.
Drinking.
I had a meeting.
Me too, but oddly, I don't reek of scotch.
Where's the nurse?
They're very busy, Joan.
You still haven't told me what happened.
She had a fall.
That's what they always say.
How did she fall?
Poor old dear had a fall.
Where did she fall?
Oh, who's she? The cat's mother?
In the kitchen.
Excuse me, I am here.
How did it happen,
Mum? I was on a chair.
What were you doing on a chair?
She was phoning you.
On a chair?
On the floor after she fell.
My battery's flat.
So I discovered halfway through a fundraising presentation.
Why do you keep sardines on the top shelf?
Fortunately, my battery wasn't flat.
Okay, St. Francis of Highgate.
What's fishy?
I'm a crap son, you're the perfect daughter-in-law. Happy?
Not perfect, just not as crap as you.
I can smell fish.
Oh, it's the kung po prawns.
You stopped off for a Chinese takeaway.
I didn't stop off. I picked it up on the way home.
And thought it would be a good idea to bring it into a hospital.
I didn't think anything.
No change there.
It was supposed to be a treat. The bag was in my hand. I heard the message and I rushed straight here.
Prawns are better than grapes.
Is that a surrealist statement or is it the medication talking?
You're not too old for a snack.
I think you'll find out very much I am.
What else did you get?
Oh, spring rolls, sweet and sour fish, monk's veg, bean curd in chili and black bean sauce.
I could kill for a spring roll.
I'm not sure you should be eating.
If the sardines had been lower down, I wouldn't be in here with a grinding stomach. Now hand over.
If you can get over the radioactive colour, I recommend the sweet and sour fish. Francis?
Oh, wait. Let's leave Joan to it. I want a word.
Well, can't we eat first?
Outside now.
Oh. What's with the whispering?
Joan didn't fall trying to reach sardines.
You're thinking what I'm thinking.
What are you thinking?
Sheltered accommodation.
That's not what I'm thinking.
Oh.
These accidents have nothing to do with senility. They're to do with Joan being pissed.
Don't be ridiculous.
Ask the doctor.
I've only ever seen her tipsy at Christmas.
Well, it's come early this year. Of course, Joan denied it, but they had a real problem working out what sedation they could give her in her condition.
Well, who can blame her if she has the occasional tipple?
I don't think we're talking about the occasional tipple.
I can't be doing with chopsticks.
At her age, she's entitled to put a shine on the grim realities of life.
I think you two may have much more in common than you realise.
Will someone fetch me a bloody fork?
Joan was kept in overnight for observation. It had been one of those days I was glad to leave behind. Francis drove us home in the hush of her new electric car. Then I crept off to my room and crawled into bed.
Well, it's not too early, is it?
Well, it depends on what for.
Well, to meet up. Talk through this job.
When?
Well, now, today. As soon as you can get into town.
The minute I arrived at Hugo's Soho office, I could tell he was on edge. So we quickly relocated to a members' club in an 18th century brothel, artfully restored to resemble an 18th century brothel. As we were led up to a private room in the attic, I had a feeling this was merely a ruse to get us either side of a bottle of scotch. I was right, and after the previous day, I was keen to hold back.
The cast have been pestering Ellie to ask me to ask you...
To ask me what?
If you'd come to the show.
One evening of amateur Marat Sard was a small price to pay in return for a high-earning voice job.
Then come back at the weekend, have a chat with them about the production.
Oh, and they want me to give notes.
But more a critique, nothing formal, just a professional perspective. I'm sorry, I know it's a big ask.
It was a colossal ask, but I'd been out of work too long to jeopardise this job with a refusal. My acceptance was Hugo's cue for a 40% proof celebration, and while I ate my own body weight in peanuts, he drank two to my one. But as the spirits went down, so did Hugo's mood.
Do you believe in bad karma?
Well, just bad advice. Bad decisions, an appalling restaurant service.
Tell me honestly, Charles, do I seem mad to you?
No. Why mad?
I feel like I'm walking a tightrope and I'm clinging on to my sanity by the skin of my teeth.
Well, you've certainly got away with a mixed metaphor.
Everything's a joke to you!
Well, it's how I deal with things.
I bet you never even think about suicide.
Hugo, I'm not sure I'm the right...
I, 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 Hugo's rules, my club, my whiskey, so you have to listen.
If I'd bolted, he probably wouldn't have remembered, but I needed that job. So I buckled up for a bumpy ride.
What the hell does any of it mean? Ginny? Ellie?
Well, you tell me.
You meet someone, get married, have kids, they grow up, suddenly parents got nothing in common.
Is that what happened with Ginny?
You ever met a moron, Charles? A full-on gold-plated schmuck, cause are you looking at one? I was a dumper, I did the walking out, and you know what? It was the biggest mistake of my puny little life.
What about Ellie?
What's the point of a younger wife you never see because she's so bored with you? She spends all her time doing amateur bloody theatricals. At least you see Francis, and I bet your kid...
Juliet's no longer a kid.
I bet she doesn't hate your guts. Mine, refused to see me. I'm the guy who's got everything and nothing. If you were me, wouldn't you want to lash out?
Drunk as he was, I didn't like the sound of this.
I mean, who'd blame me if I just...
What?
So what do you think, Mad? Or not mad?
Mad people don't think they're mad. Maybe you should get some help.
What, are you my shrink all of a sudden?
No, but I drink too much, which qualifies me to recognise when someone else does.
You self-satisfied prick!
Well, that was a waste of good scotch. Feel better?
I need a drink.
Leaving Hugo slumped in a wing-back chair, I emerged into the reassuringly stale Soho air. Heading home, I tried to shrug the afternoon off. Hugo was volatile, but violent? No. But time changes people, and this was a side I'd never seen.
Hi, Francis.
They're sending Joan home.
Home?
Oh, don't be stupid. She's in plaster. It looks like she'll be with us till Christmas, which is good.
What definition of good is that?
We're going to have to help her, Charles, but I think this is going to be good for you, too.
Why don't I like the sound of this?
Try thinking of it as an opportunity.
What are you talking about?
A dry Christmas. Charles? Are you there, Charles?
In episode one of An Amateur Corpse, Charles was played by Bill Nighy, Francis by Suzanne Burden, and Joan by Geraldine McEwen. Hugo was Paul Ritter, Jeff, Patrick Brennan, Clive, Sam Alexander, Saskia, Christine Absalom, and Ellie, Amaka Okafor. An Amateur Corpse was written by Jeremy Front and based on the novel by Simon Brett. The director was Sally Avens. A Charles Paris mystery, An Amateur Corpse, written by Jeremy Front, based on the novel by Simon Brett. Episode 2.
Let me be completely honest. An amateur production of Marat Sade in a desanctified church is not my idea of a good night out.
Marat, we are poor!
Especially sober. My old friend Hugo was putting some voice work my way, so when he told me his wife Ellie was playing Charlotte Corday, I couldn't very well refuse.
And the poor stay poor!
And I was sober because my mother was staying with us and Francis had a bee in a bonnet that Joan was on the juice. But the only thing getting me through the evening was the promise of a post-show drink.
Let me die now.
Thanks for coming, Charles.
It was a real pleasure.
Liar.
Well, it was good to see you on stage at last.
Didn't I say Ellie was brilliant?
She was also beautiful, half his age, and punching way below her weight. Attractive younger woman marries rich businessman. Who'd have thought?
She shows out the rest of them.
They will hear you.
I don't envy you, Charles. Have your work cut out at that critics' forum.
Yeah.
In a moment of madness, I'd rashly agreed to return on Friday night to give my professional thoughts on the production. Well, Hugo was giving me work, so how could I say no?
They all take themselves terribly seriously, so if I were you, I'd shoot from the hip.
Are you sure?
They definitely don't want flattery. Tell them what you think.
Ellie,
Excuse me. I better do some hellos.
Oh. Another drink?
I've got to make a move. I'm working tomorrow.
Oh, boring.
I'm working for you.
Oh, in that case, you can go. And, hey, thanks, Charlie. Ellie really appreciated it.
Pleasure.
Talk to her.
I'm shaving.
Just talk to her.
Why?
She's your mother. And stop rolling your eyes like a teenage boy.
Teenage boys get more privacy than I do. After a fall, my mother's temporary residence was fast becoming permanent.
A couple of minor mishaps and you're convinced Joan's on the sauce or losing her marbles.
She could be depressed.
I'd be depressed if people kept banging on every time I had a little accident.
Your little accidents are always booze-related.
On the upside, if she is depressed, we don't need to have a dry Christmas.
You've fallen off the wagon already, haven't you?
Will you stop badgering me in the bathroom?
Badgering's a gender-laden euphemism for nagging, which men use when women try to persuade them to grow up and take responsibility.
Whoa, woman's hour started early today. I don't ask much, just a little me time.
Your entire life consists of me time. Joan needs someone to talk to, and you're the one to do it.
I'm really not.
She's your mother.
I've got a busy day.
Charles!
Okay, I'll talk to her.
Thank you.
Now, would it be out of the question for me to have 5 minutes privacy?
Of course.
Oh, stop it.
Okay, Mum, I've actually got some work.
And
so...
you are the most dreadful schmoozer.
I'm going out now.
Who's that?
Shh, I'm on the phone. No, not you.
Who are you talking to?
I bet you say that to all the girls.
Girls?
Shut up, Charles. As it happens, I did dance when I was younger. My mother even taught me to Charleston.
Are you channeling Gypsy Rose Lee?
Charming as this has been, Morris.
Morris?
Charles wants to talk to
you. No.
Take the phone.
Don't tell him I'm working.
What?
Tell him I'm dead.
He says he's dead, so I'm putting you through to his answer phone. Just grow up and talk to your agent.
You're through to the voicemail of the late Charles Paris. Please leave a message of condolence after the tone. Beep.
Sadly missed, blah, blah, blah. Greatly loved in the profession, blah, blah, blah. Always the consummate professional. Especially when drunk and singing in a gutter.
You've just talked yourself out of giving my eulogy.
A disappointment I'll shoulder, along with your coffin.
I'm going to be cremated.
I think you mean flambé.
Where the hell have you been, Morris? You haven't returned my calls in months.
You can always talk to Pixie if I'm out of the office.
I don't want to badmouth your trust fund intern, but I'd get more work sticking postcards in phone boxes.
In straitened times, that kind of initiative could play in your favour. Ladies of a certain age like a mature escort.
I'm not mature.
Self-awareness at last.
And don't flirt with Joan.
Oh, she's fun.
No, she's not. She's my mother. And she's old enough to be yours.
You used to be fun, Charles.
There's a recession. Fun's on the ration. And you still haven't said where you've been. More to the point, why haven't you been in touch?
Great agents, amongst whom I count myself, don't whore themselves around like wannabes from Towie.
What's Towie?
The only way is Essex. Don't you watch telly?
Only if it's got subtitles or presented by someone with a PhD in a proper subject.
Unemployment's wasted on you.
Just remind me, what you actually do for me?
As a top industry professional, I work discreetly behind the scenes. I pass, like night, from land to land.
Bar to bar.
I have strange power of speech.
It's called bullshit.
Would you rather I was chewing the fat with you, or hanging with players who can offer you work?
I won't even entertain such a ludicrous fantasy.
Are you doubting my contacts? My database is the envy of the profession.
It's not a profession, it's a mob. What is the collective noun for agents? An adjunct?
I didn't phone you to trade insults.
A percentage?
Most amusing.
A sponge.
Finished?
Barely started.
Pity, because I've got you a job.
What?
And it's a film.
Film?
Only a small part.
Blah, but a film.
They want to see you this morning.
I can't do this morning.
Of course you can.
I can't.
It was sod's law, but what could I do? I was under contract to Hugo.
I'm busy this morning.
Very good. You nearly had me there.
Seriously, I've got things to do.
What things?
Private things.
Hugo's voice job was my first work in months and promised to be a nice little earner. So I had to think fast to stop Morris, the old bloodsucker, creaming off 10% for sitting on his backside.
Come on, Charles. I'm your agent. I'm practically your doctor. You can confide in me.
I can't. I really can't. It's too personal.
Personal?
Yeah.
Is it rehab at last?
I'm not allowed to say.
Oh, this is very difficult. But seeing as it's you, I'll try to reschedule.
Thanks.
Charles?
What?
If it is rehab, you're doing the right thing.
Cheers, Morris.
Good to know you're there for me.
I wouldn't go that far.
Last time I saw Hugo, he was wallowing in self-pity and drowning his sorrows in scotch that wasn't making him any happier. So it was a relief to find him perky, sober, and highly professional. Sport and Drive for Men is anatomically shaped and made from a revolutionary, super-absorbent material. So, if you're one of the 3.6 million men with bladder weakness, you need never stop the big game. Sport and Drive for Men. Keep on playing.
Yeah, that was good, Charlie.
I wouldn't mind going again.
Sounds like you need the product.
Thank you.
Let's try one with a bit more energy.
You mean faster?
More pace, a bit sportier, aspirational.
Sporty, aspirational incontinence pads. Okay. Okay, Hugo, ready when you are.
And green light coming.
Sport and Drive for Men is anatomically shaped and made from a revolutionary superabsorbent material. So, if you're one of the 3.6 million men with bladder weakness, you need never stop the big game. Sport and Drive for Men. Keep on playing.
Okay, you were great, but we had some technical problems, so let's go one more time.
We went dozens more times before Hugo was happy, so it was past lunchtime when he suggested we adjourn to his club. Despite my better instincts, I agreed.
Ah, onwards and upwards.
Cheers.
Now, if the suits at Sport and Dry go for the test, and between you and me, I'll be amazed if they don't, we'll have a very nice little bonus at the end of the year.
I'll drink to that.
Out of interest, you be up for more?
Too right, I'm always up for work.
Good, because there's a few things crossed my desk which could have your name on them.
Count me in.
Well, let's drink to it.
It's no secret I'm a long way from abstemious, but Hugo had downed a second quadruple and was pouring a third. He was doing 3-1, a good return on the horses, but a hell of a hangover in a bar.
Now, I don't want to come between an actor and his agent, but I get the feeling you and, what's his name?
Morris.
Yeah, you and Morris are not the best fit.
Well, it's like a marriage. We've been together so long, I can't imagine life without him.
Does he handle everything?
Given the chance, he'll take his cut of nothing.
You know, my company's got a small list of clients.
I didn't.
Now, it's strictly voice work. We're not general agents. Look, don't want to be cited in a divorce, but... I reckon we could put a lot your way, if you're interested.
I'm interested.
Well, look, we'd love to have you, so why don't you sleep on it?
Yeah.
Check out our clients on the website. Let me know Friday.
Friday?
The Critics Forum.
Oh, of course.
You'd forgotten.
No. I'll be there. Try keeping me away.
Great. Fancy a plate of pasta?
Yeah.
Glad of an excuse to avoid confronting my mother, I spent an hour in a Soho trat helping Hugo demolish 4 bottles of Valpolicella.
I chip my head to the new constitution, take a bow for the new revolution, smile and grin at the change all around, I pick up my guitar and play, don't like it!
Yes, you know what we should do?
Yeah, go home.
Go clubbing!
Oh, I could never hurt a seal, those big eyes.
No, seriously, Charlie.
Aren't you tired?
Well, nothing some MDA won't sort out. We'll meet some girls, dance all night.
Have a cardiac arrest in the morning.
It'll be fun.
It'll be humiliating. If you want to go clubbing, you have my blessing and joy.
Well, I'm not going on my own.
Well, it's your choice, but I'm too...
Don't you dare say it!
No.
Hugo's rules.
What?
The O word is bad.
Well, how about the K word, as in knackered?
Right, what about lap dancing?
A room full of men looking at women who despise them is not my idea of erotic entertainment.
All right, then, burlesque.
Striptease for Guardian readers.
Oh, Charlie!
You've got a beautiful young wife at home. Go and spend the evening looking at her.
You're no fun.
Yeah, I bet she is.
What's that mean?
Nothing.
Well, have people been talking?
No, Hugo, I promise.
Another of my little accidents, only this time I seem to have inadvertently stumbled into a raw nerve.
Go home, Hugo.
Well, what's the point? Ellie won't be there. She never is.
Come away from the curb.
Always at a bloody drama group, or so she said.
Watch it!
Sorry, he's had a few.
Let's get you to a station.
Where have all the good
times gone? I should have bailed out, but was worried Hugo would fall under a train. Unfortunately, escorting him home meant passing the de-sanctified church theatre.
Let's go and surprise Ellie. Oh. I really love her, you know. She's a beautiful girl.
With a boozer's bipolarity, he'd swung from self-pity and anger about his neglectful wife to Dickensian sentiment.
She deserves better than me. I'm waiting for the contradiction.
Oh, I'm sure you're a very attentive husband.
First time I've been called attentive. Peace be upon this house of prayer.
Oh, God.
I got the wrong night for the Critics Forum, he asked nervously.
Charles has just popped in for a drink.
Actually, I can't stay.
Of course you can.
I'll get this.
Very Christian of you, Jeff.
By day, Jeff Winter was an architect. By night, leading man and sometime director.
Very large scotch, Hugo?
Supersize me and Charles will have the same.
Actually,
very large scotches when you have a minute, Owen.
God. Where is everyone?
Someone's being killed off on EastEnders.
Hugo led me to a corner table.
One for the road and then I'll walk you home.
Oh, you're like a mother hen.
It's my mother I'm thinking about. She's staying with us.
But Joan?
Yeah.
Oh, she let me sleep on her floor when we toured the Alchemical Roadshow. Oh, she was fun.
So I'm told.
Very fond memories.
Really?
Very. Back in the day, I had a bit of a thing about her.
What?
No, quite a thing.
This is my mother you're talking about.
Well, she was hot.
Oh, please.
Well, it's just a youthful crush.
Oh, that's okay, then.
No, I didn't make a move.
This is an Oedipal nightmare.
There we go, gents.
Sinking his scotch with joyless urgency, playful Hugo was replaced by his solemn doppelganger, who slouched off to the bar for a refuel.
We're all looking forward to your feedback. It's good for us amateurs to get a professional response.
Well, I'll do my best.
But you must be honest. Shoot from the hip. Don't hold back. We want discourse, not flattery, he said with trepidation.
Are you schmoozing the critic?
I was telling him not to pull his punches.
Feel free to ignore my husband. If you want to throw any compliments my way, I'm happy to receive them. Is Ellie here, Hugo? Mr. Chuckles, his usual fun-loving self.
Where is everyone?
Watching telly, Clive.
How depressing is that?
You can't blame people when they've had a hard day at work or a harder day out of work.
I'm surprised at you, Charles.
Clive was such a pompous little prig. The contrarian in me had to put up a defence for popular entertainment. Also, I'd seen him act, and he was less method, more methadone.
Jeff, I've been doing some research into Brechtian techniques of alienation.
Actually, we've got to get going soon, haven't we, Sass?
Mm? Oh, yes.
Okay. Anyone seen Ellie?
Hugo's at the bar, ask him.
Good luck with that. Should be a full house for your talk.
Oh, really? Oh, dear.
You're not worried, are you?
Just speak as you find.
I don't want to tread on any toes.
Well, how the hell should I know?
Here we go.
What does everyone think I know or care where my bloody wife is?
Come on, Hugo, let's get you home.
Oh, don't come on, Hugo, me.
Let's get some air.
I don't want air, I want a drink.
Don't you think you've had enough?
Get off me, Charles!
Do you know what? I've had enough for one night. You can bloody well get yourself home.
No, Charlie.
Hello?
Ellie, it's Charles. Listen, I've just left Hugo in the theatre bar.
How bad?
I think you might need to pick him up. He got upset and... Well, he threw a punch at me. Oh,
Charles, I'm so sorry. Are you all right?
He's so far gone, he barely brushed me.
What am I going to do with him?
Well, if you want my honest opinion, he needs to get help.
Maybe he'll listen to you.
Trust me, where Hugo is, the only person he'll listen to is himself.
Oh, it's so frustrating. I'd better come and collect him.
I'll see you at the critics thing tomorrow.
You're still going to do it after this?
Well, I never break a promise.
It was a lie, but Hugo was an old friend, and now he was ill, I couldn't just dump him.
There's more food if anyone wants some.
I couldn't.
I could.
Not you.
Oh. Did you know we used to call him the Gannet?
Great child psychologists, my parents. It's amazing I didn't develop an eating disorder.
He loves to melodramatize his terrible childhood.
Freud would have a field day with it.
Penis this and penis that.
Oh. Are you talking about Freud or Charles's childhood?
Oh. Well, now you mention
it... Can we change the subject?
Of course. It's not your fault.
Hold the front page. Something's not my fault.
All men are driven from below the belt.
Well, hang on. She makes these sweeping assertions.
Anyone fancy some cheese?
Ask Desmond Morris.
Oddly enough, I haven't got him on speed dial.
Or fruit. I'm not blaming you, Charles.
We've got some nice apples.
You're programmed to have sex on the brain.
Oh.
Actually, she's got a point.
I don't believe this.
Your father was the same.
I don't want to know!
Right, I'll clear the table.
I'll do it.
No! You stay and talk to your mum.
If he's offering to help, I'd let him.
There you are, Francis. Last one in the kitchen to sissy. Oh. What is the tariff for matricide?
Talk to her, Charles.
I was talking to her, and now my blood pressure's through the roof.
It may be part of her condition.
What condition? She was always like this.
She wasn't always falling off stools and setting fire to her bedding.
Anyone can leave a styling wand on, and old people have falls. If you hadn't put the sardines on such a high shelf, she wouldn't have been standing on a stool.
It had nothing to do with sardines. I don't know if she's drinking.
I wouldn't blame her if she was.
Or just having senior moments.
I'll lose my marbles before she does.
It's not a joke, Charles. Go in and talk to her.
No.
What if she's not able to go back to her own house?
I'll go and talk to her. anything good on?
Don't be silly, Charles.
Oh, sorry. So, how's the leg?
Stiff.
You doing the exercises?
For what good they are?
That physio knows her stuff.
How do you know?
Well, she seemed very, nice.
Why are there so many comedians?
What?
They're everywhere.
Well, people like to laugh.
But you can't turn on Newsnight without some stand-up putting the world to rights. I suppose it's the decline of religion.
Sorry?
Comedians are the new bishops. Morecambe and Wise never appeared on Question Time talking about the national deficit.
Fair point.
I've made you some tea.
Thanks.
And one for you, Charles.
Right.
How's it going?
It's not.
Well, try harder. I'll, leave you to it.
Leave us to what?
Francis thinks we should have a chat.
Chat? About what? Can I tell you something, Charles?
Of course.
You're from the let's talk about it generation. My age group tend to bottle things up. We had problems just like you. In fact, we had it a lot harder. I'm not saying people didn't complain. We are British. Moaning's our birthright. But then we shut up and got on with things.
So you're telling me to shut up?
I know we're supposed to wear our feelings on our sleeves, but there's a lot to be said for good old English emotional repression, sweeping things under the carpet and minding our own damn business.
Right. Anything else?
That's it.
Good. Well, I've enjoyed our little chat.
Mm. Be a dear. And see if there are any biscuits to go with my tea.
Right.
Needless to say, Francis was not best pleased. It may not have been a bonding moment, but I respected Joan for unapologetically crushing my ham-fisted attempt to counsel her.
Now, when I was a young boy, at the age of five, my mama said I was going to be the greatest man alive.
What a racket.
This racket is muddy waters.
Not him, you.
Oh.
Sorry to be the bearer of bad news, but you're not black, just pale grey like your father. And he was from Woking, not the Mississippi Delta.
You don't have to be black to sing the blues.
You have to be able to sing.
If I need my self-esteem lowered, I'll call Morris.
Where's Francis?
Gone to work. Oh, and I'm eating out tonight. I've got to talk to a group of amateurs about their show.
What's the smell?
Bubble and squeak. I'm using the leftovers. Do you want some?
I suppose it's all fat and carbohydrate.
Afraid so.
Go on, then.
Fried egg on top.
In for a penny, in for a seizure.
Oh, great timing.
I'll get it. Hello, Morris.
Oh, my favourite client's mother.
He says you're his favourite client, Charles.
I meant favourite mother of a client, but let's not disabuse him.
What does he want?
I heard that. Can you tell him that thanks to my ineffable charm, I've managed to reschedule the film casting, and they'll see him today at 12.
I'll pass it on.
Thank you, Joan. Love you and leave you. Ciao, Bella.
Ciao, amore. he's a rogue.
That's one word for him. Grub up.
After breakfast, I was just looking at Hugo's website, checking out his select yet impressive client list when...
Hello.
And how are you this fine day?
More to the point, how are you?
Actually, I feel better than I've any right to, which is one of the reasons I'm calling. Ellie says I'll be lucky if you ever speak to me again.
She's right, you behaved like a grade A arse.
For which I can't apologise enough, mea culpa. I throw myself on your mercy.
You can get up again.
Tell the truth, I don't remember much about it.
I wouldn't mind if you had the grace to have the hangover from hell.
Well, can you find it in your heart to forgive me? No, don't answer till I give you the good news.
Sport and Dry loved our test and wanted Hugo to book me for the whole campaign. The bad news was they wanted it yesterday, which meant I couldn't make the film casting again.
No, Charles. I refuse to beg for another reschedule. I bent over backwards to get you this casting, and it's not as if you were their first choice.
Cheers, Morris. That's put a spring in my step.
Oh, grow up, Charles.
And I'm fed up with people telling me to grow up. But while we're telling it like it is, let me remind you that you've got me precisely nothing in months.
Is this assertiveness part of your therapy?
What therapy?
The rehab.
I'm not in rehab.
Then why can't you make the casting?
Because clashes with a job.
What job?
A voice job.
I haven't got you a voice job.
No, my voice agent has. Hello? Morris?
Judas.
What?
Brutus.
Make up your mind.
I feel sullied.
Slight overreaction.
How could you be so disloyal?
What's loyalty got to do with it? Lots of actors have voice agents.
I am a voice agent.
Since when?
It's on the website.
I've got better things to do than look at your website.
Yes. Like getting work behind my back. Morris Skellen Associates offers multi-platform, pan-discipline representation dealing with all aspects of the industry in conjunction with its sister agency, MSV, Morris Skellen Voices.
You never told me you handled voice work.
You never asked.
I shouldn't need to.
You choose a voice job over a film. I feel betrayed.
You haven't even told me what this film is. Is it a feature?
It's a short.
Director?
She's a very exciting, dynamic young filmmaker.
A student.
Today's student is tomorrow's wunderkind. Attach yourself to a rising star, and the potential exposure could be a game changer.
You mean it's unpaid?
You see, this is your problem, Charles. No foresight.
Goodbye, Morris. As if one unpaid gig wasn't enough, I had another one that night.
I must say, it's very gratifying to see such a turnout for our regular critics' forum.
The amateur cast were out in force and had been getting tanked in the bar for at least an hour before Jeff did an introduction.
Tonight's guest critic is a familiar face not only from his stage work, but also from Series 3 of Holby City and Episode 5, Series 5 of Monarch of the Glen.
He'd cobbled it together from my Wikipedia entry, so it ranged from inaccurate to complete fiction. On the plus side, they'd knocked 5 years off my age, so I wasn't complaining.
He is also a familiar voice from his many radio appearances, including one in which he read the amusing quotes for quote-unquote.
So far, the only faces missing were Ellie and Hugo, who roped me into this damn thing.
Anyway, that's enough from me, so, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce Charles Paris.
Wow. Thank you, good evening. Let me say at the outset, it was a very brave decision for an amateur company to stage Marit's art.
Excuse me?
Well, I'll be taking questions at the end.
Yeah, but could I just say we prefer to think of ourselves as fringe rather than amateur? Yeah.
Okay.
We think it better for our critics to think of us as peers and not to pull their punches. Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you for that. In that case, let's cut to the chase and address my main problem. Is it actually advisable for a fringe company to attempt to stage such a challenging piece?
Oh, now, hang on.
My understanding of the phrases shoot from the hip and not pulling my punches clearly wasn't theirs.
Are you calling us pretentious?
Yeah. Well, no, if you'd just hear me out, and I didn't actually say the word pretentious. But they didn't hear me out, and the evening only got worse. Somewhat piqued, lucky to escape with my life and with angry voices still ringing in my ears, I made my way to Hugo's house.
It's you.
Thanks for coming.
Huh?
My talk, the critics' bloody forum you roped me into.
You want a drink?
No. Yes, actually, yes, I do. And you better make it a big one. The place was a mess, and so was Hugo. I thought Ellie at least would have been there.
Ellie's gone.
What do you mean, gone? Gone where?
Well, gone. It's over. She's not here.
When did you last see her?
Last night.
What about this morning, before work?
Well, I didn't see it this morning or when I got back this afternoon.
How much have you drunk since you got back?
I don't know, 2, 3.
I could tell he didn't mean glasses.
I woke up in that armchair. God, the house is freezing!
Well, let's get that fire lit. Where'd you keep the log?
There's a shed behind the studio.
Right.
I made my way across the extensive lawn towards the smoked glass cube. In the pitch dark, I remembered just in time there was a swimming pool between the house and Hugo's studio.
Sod this for a game of cards.
Feeling my way into a plastic garden chair, I took out my emergency cigarettes and flicked the lighter. As the flame flared and flickered, I made out a shape underneath the pool cover.
Oh, no. Hugo!
The water was ice cold as I tore at the heavy cover.
Hugo!
But there was no need to hurry. Ellie was floating face down, and it looked like she'd been there some time.
In episode 2 of An Amateur Corpse, Charles was played by Bill Nighy, Francis by Suzanne Burden, and Joan by Geraldine McEwen. Hugo was Paul Ritter. Ellie, Amaka Okafor. Morris, John Glover. Jeff, Patrick Brennan. Saskia, Christine Absalom. And Clive, Sam Alexander. An Amateur Corpse was written by Jeremy Front and based on the novel by Simon Brett. The director was Sally Aidens.
This video was uploaded to the channel Thinking Out Louder. Please like, comment and subscribe to the Thinking Out Louder channel. Thank you.
A Charles Paris mystery, An Amateur Corpse. Written by Jeremy Front, based on the novel by Simon Brett. Episode 3.
Are you the person who called for the ambulance?
Yes, I'm the one who found her. I managed to pull her out, but...
Okay, sir, if you could just show us where she is.
Okay.
Soaking, freezing, still in shock, I led the paramedics through Hugo's expensive house and into the expansive garden. The optimist in me hoped to find Ellie alive, well, and wrapped in a bathrobe. In reality, she sprawled lifeless where I'd fished her out of the pool. While the paramedics attended to the body, I attended to Hugo.
The police will be here any minute.
What have I done, Charles? Well, how do you mean? I'm bad news. And Ellie should never have married me. Ginny should never have married me. I've ruined every relationship I've ever had.
You're in shock.
Oh, I'm toxic to women.
Ellie loved you.
She was wasted on me.
I've got to get dry, Hugo. I'm freezing to death. Not death, sorry.
She's so young.
Would you be okay for a minute while I find a towel?
Oh, so beautiful.
I might need to borrow some dry clothes, too.
Hurrying upstairs, I peeled off my wet clothes, peered into a laundry basket, and requisitioned one of Hugo's inappropriately youthful hoodies and a weird pair of jeans. I was fighting with the latter when my phone rang.
Bad timing, Francis.
Are you being chased by angry actors brandishing pitchforks?
I'm trying to get into someone's trousers.
Your night must have gone better than expected.
Trust me, it really didn't.
Didn't the am-drammers appreciate your critique?
I'd been coerced to give my thoughts on an amateur production of Marat Sade, and although the cast hadn't actually driven me out of town with flaming torches, Francis wasn't far off the mark.
I don't understand these trousers.
Do trousers need to be understood?
They don't fit in any one place. How can they be hanging off my waist and clinging to my calves? I look like I'm auditioning for Aladdin.
They sound like carrot tops.
Whatever they are, they're bloody uncomfortable.
Whose are they?
Hugo's.
Why are you putting on Hugo's trousers?
Mine got wet while I was pulling his wife out of the outdoor pool, and before you ask, I wasn't drunk.
Methinks he protests too much.
Believe me, after the evening I've just had, I wish I was drunk.
You haven't been playing Scrabble with Joan.
No, but I've found Hugo's wife drowned in their pool.
What?
Yeah, hence the wet clothes.
That's horrible.
I saw something underneath the pool cover when I stopped for a cigarette.
Oh, Charles.
Hey, I'm practically off the sauce. Don't beat me up over a single fag.
That was a sympathy O, not a judgmental O.
Oh, well, thanks. I think that's the police. Listen, I see a long night ahead, so I wouldn't wait up.
Mr. Paris, sorry to keep you waiting.
How's Hugo?
In shock, understandably.
Yeah.
What time did you get here this evening?
I ran through the main events. I could have skipped the fact that my mother was staying with me and Francis, but in an attempt to prove myself innocent of any wrongdoing, my nerves ran away with me.
Because she fell off a chair, like I said to my wife. Joan's not getting any younger, so why shouldn't she?
If we could get back to the events of this evening.
Oh, of course, sorry.
You say you and Mr. Menkin are old friends.
We hadn't seen each other for ages till recently.
But you'd say you know him well.
We were students together back in the 70s. Mm. We toured in Mr. MacGuffin's Alchemical Roadshow. You're too young to remember. It was a pretty hardcore, radical company.
I'm more of a Lloyd Webber man.
Ah.
So, you and Mr. Menkin go back a way?
Yeah, I remember his first wedding.
What happened to that marriage?
Divorce.
Do you know why?
Well, who can say what goes on in other people's marriages? It was meant as a perfectly innocent truism, but the detective gave me the gimlet eye, waiting for more. All Hugo told me was that he'd had some kind of midlife cliché. He and Ginny had been together years, then the kids grew up. He met Ellie, she was young. He was flattered, you know the story.
Do you happen to know if he had a lot of extramarital relationships?
I couldn't say.
And since you got back together, has he said anything about his marriage?
Not much. I think he was a bit frustrated the amount of time she spent with her drama group.
Frustrated?
She was out a lot at rehearsals and stuff.
So you think he felt neglected?
Well, Ellie's acting career hadn't taken off, so she joined a local group to sort of keep her hand in. And Hugo started out as an actor, so he knows what it's like.
What is it like?
Acting? Well, mainly quiet, with periods of intense activity followed by complete silence.
Do you think Mr. Menkin suspected his wife was having a relationship within this drama group?
All I had to do was keep it simple and say no.
No.
I mean, she was a striking-looking woman. She was bound to attract male attention. I seemed to have developed Tourette's. I just wanted to tell the truth, but I couldn't open my mouth without throwing a shadow of suspicion.
Does Mr. Menkin have much of a temper?
Well, we all have our moments.
What sort of moments does he have?
In the past few days, Hugo had smashed a bottle against a wall and taken a swing at me. The last outburst had also been witnessed by a bar full of amateur actors. He may be a little volatile.
One more thing. Does Mr. Menkin have a drink problem?
Yes, he does. Well, what else could I say? It didn't take police training to smell the alcohol on Hugo's breath.
Thank you, Mr. Paris. If you could give your contact details to WPC Marsh in case we need to be in touch.
Right. Everyone was asleep by the time I got home. And dog-tired, I crawled onto my bed, still wearing Hugo's cast-me-offs.
Morning.
What time is it?
Nearly 8.
Which one?
A.M. I thought you might like a coffee.
What's wrong?
I just thought you'd appreciate the gesture after last night.
Sorry. I do. Cheers.
The story's made the Southeast News.
Oh, poor Hugo.
You should also know.
What?
They've arrested him.
No!
They're making it sound like he's the main suspect.
Oh.
What's the phrase they use? The police are not pursuing any other lines of inquiry.
Oh, what have I done?
What have you done?
It's my fault.
Ellie's drowning.
Hugo's arrest.
What's it got to do with you?
I had to give a statement, but whatever I said came out wrong.
I'm sure you're imagining it.
I'm really not, Francis. Every time I spoke, I dug Hugo deeper into a hole. What am I going to do?
What can you do?
Well, I can't let an innocent man go to prison.
Whoa. Slow down and rewind. You don't know that he'd be found guilty.
If they're not looking for anyone else.
I know Hugo's a friend, but do you know he's innocent?
You're not serious.
I'm just saying.
Don't be ridiculous.
They say anyone's capable of murder given the right circumstances.
Don't look at me like that. Hello?
Are you decent?
That's a leading question.
Oh, you
you're in there too, Francis. I don't want to interrupt anything.
Just come in, Mum.
Not if you're having a rapprochement.
Our rapprochement days are long over, aren't they, Charles?
I feel uncomfortable with this conversation.
Why are you dressed like a teenage skateboarder?
Are those the clothes you came home in?
I don't think you're right for a hoodie and carrot tops.
What do you know about carrot tops?
I keep up with current trends, and let me tell you, this one's not for you.
I'll bear it in mind.
Try growing old with dignity, Charles.
Was there something you wanted?
My leg feels a lot better, so I think it's time I pulled my weight.
Well, you mustn't overdo it.
No, we don't want any setbacks now you're on the mend.
I'm so bored stuck indoors. You'd be doing me a favour.
What do you want to do?
How about I make dinner tonight?
You don't have to get adventurous.
Charles doesn't trust my cooking.
It's not that.
Thanks, Joan. That would be lovely.
Good. So, straight home after school and no skateboarding with your crew.
Oh, what did you say about anyone being capable of murder?
I hadn't spoken to Morris since his hissy fit about my voice agent. I also hadn't had a drink for 24 hours, and I couldn't face one without the other.
There you go, Charles. One extra large double.
Cheers. As my new voice agent was now on a murder charge, I took it upon myself to be the adult and call Morris.
Charles! Good of you to find the time in your busy schedule to call your agent of several decades standing.
I wanted to clear the air.
The air's perfectly fresh in W1. Is there a sulphurous whiff of perfidy in N6?
My conscience is spotless.
That's what counts.
I don't know why you're being so prickly.
There's nothing prickly about me.
Can I point out that practically every actor I know has separate representation for voice work?
Even when their acting agent runs his own voice agency?
Which you never told me about.
Because you never asked.
I shouldn't have to ask.
Perhaps if you showed more interest in the agency.
I give you 10% plus VAT. I didn't realise I had to follow you on the FTSE 100.
Oh, no.
Now you're just being childish.
I'm not the childish one.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not.
You are.
I'm not.
Are.
You're the one who expects me to do everything for you.
Something would be nice once in a while.
If this is your idea of clearing the air.
Okay, let's just draw a line under the whole thing.
Let's.
Good.
Right.
Fine.
So.
Is there much happening?
Work?
In quantum mechanics? Yes, work.
Well, that depends.
On what?
The client.
Let me rephrase. Is there much happening for this client?
Surely you're too busy with your burgeoning voice career.
Okay, Morris, you've made your point. Forget work. Is there any juicy gossip?
Well, even that's gone quiet in the recession.
You think people have stopped having illicit sex?
It's not called a downswing for nothing. Oh, there's the Hugo Menken case. You knew him, didn't you?
Don't recall.
You were both in that anarcho-syndicalist science fiction touring company.
No, I don't
Mr.
think...
Mr. McGuffin's Alchemical Roadshow.
You know what they say. If you remember the 70s, you weren't there.
Oh, I remember it only too well. How could I forget Charles Paris naked, apart from German expressionist body paint?
I was young and needed the money.
No one got paid.
It was worth it for the makeup girl.
You do remember it. Once he embraced free market capitalism, Hugo did very nicely for himself.
Oh, I wouldn't know.
Cashed in his ideological chips, set up a voiceover company and made a heap.
Really?
And now he's facing a murder charge.
Oh, terrible.
I thought you'd show a bit more interest in your old friend.
Well, I haven't seen him in a long time.
Oh, yes, it must be, what, a few days since you did that test for the Sport and Dry commercial? Are you there, Charles? You've gone very quiet.
You've been playing me.
Aren't I wicked? Know this about me. Nothing gets past Morris. Enjoy your whiskey.
At a loose end and feeling guilty that I'd fueled the flames of suspicion against Hugo, I looked up the time of his hearing and made my way over to Wimbledon Magistrates Court. I was early enough to catch the support act. From the public gallery, I stared down at a scowling ne'er-do-well with the classic features of fetal alcohol poisoning, a crookshank illustration of low-life made flesh. And that was just the magistrate. Eventually, Hugo was led up from the cells. Suited and booted, he looked hunched, exhausted, and bewildered.
Are you Mr. Hugo Menken of Elmview, the Avenue, Surrey?
Yes.
Could you speak up, please?
Yes.
The hearing only took a few minutes from beginning to end, and the magistrate decided that the accused should be held on remand.
Well,
Together. It was so depressing.
Where's he being held?
Wormwood Scrubs, but I think remand prisoners can get moved around. What's she making out there?
Since I got in, I haven't been allowed in the kitchen.
Oh.
Buggeration.
I'd better go.
Leave her to it. She wants to do her bit.
Well, she could join the territorial army.
She's bored out of her mind.
That's no reason to risk life and limb. When my mother gets experimental, you don't know what you're going to get.
Hypocrite.
What?
Mediterranean fish cake.
Smells good.
I got the recipe and ingredients from that gorgeous boy at your Italian deli.
The boy must be 50 if he's a day.
He's very charming.
He can certainly charm the cash out of your wallet.
It's my money.
Yes, don't be so ungrateful.
Sorry.
The plates are hot.
Yeah. Well, I must say, they look great.
Mm. Good. Well, tuck in.
My tongue won't work.
My lips are shriveling.
Oh, add some more water, Joan.
My mouth seems to be contracting.
Mine's turning inside out.
Everyone, keep drinking.
Oh, you know you're supposed to soak salt cod overnight.
He said rinse it.
Yeah, about 100 times.
It's not Joan's fault.
Well, thank you, Francis.
I wonder what this will do to my hypertension.
I can literally feel my blood pressure rising, and only some of that's due to the salt.
Well, I'll do something simpler tomorrow night.
Okay.
If you'll excuse me, I'm going to stand in the shower with my mouth open.
My taste buds were still traumatised the next day, as a prison warder searched me for drugs and weapons before ushering me through several sets of forbidding security gates.
Yeah, thanks for coming, Charles.
How are you doing?
Yeah, could murder a drink.
Afraid I can't help you there.
No.
Apart from that?
You know, not too bad.
Yeah. Really?
Actually, I'm scared witless. Last night they put me on suicide watch.
Why?
I suppose if a man's unstable enough to kill his wife...
But you didn't. Hugo?
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know?
I don't know, Charles.
Keep it down or they'll chuck me out.
But you saw how far gone I was the other night. I was drunk enough to take a swing at you.
But to kill someone, and not just someone, but Ellie.
I don't know. I don't know anything anymore.
When I left the bar, you could barely stand up.
Well, you remember more than I do.
But you remember Ellie coming to pick you up?
Just about. I got little flashback fragments. She was pretty damn annoyed when she put me in the car. I think we had a row on the way home.
About what?
About what an arse I was. Now, I probably said some pretty horrible stuff too, but don't ask me what.
And when you got home?
More shouting, more fighting.
Fighting?
Yeah, figuratively speaking.
Did you touch her?
I don't know.
Did you touch her, Hugh?
I don't know.
Well, think.
Maybe a push.
What the hell does that mean?
Look, my memory may be screwed, but one thing I know, I don't hit women. Of course, that doesn't mean I didn't kill Ellie.
Is that what you told the police?
Oh, they came to their own conclusion.
I'm trying to help you.
That's nice of you. And look, don't take this the wrong way, but you're an actor, not a lawyer.
I'd still like to help, if you'll let me.
I was drunk when Ellie picked me up. We rowed, she stormed out of the room. I carried on drinking.
Stormed out where?
Well, I fell asleep in an armchair, so as far as I know, she could have gone to bed or... driven off to see her lover.
What lover? Was she having an affair?
I don't know.
Well, was she or wasn't she?
I never caught her in flagrante, but... Well, you know the signs. Whispered phone calls and quickly hanging up when I walked in, going out to meet a friend.
Any particular friend?
Would have been no shortage of applicants.
At the drama group?
You saw the way they all sniffed around her.
I'd seen cocksure Clive trying his luck, but Ellie gave him the brush off in no uncertain terms. On the other hand, Clive might not be good at taking no for an answer.
Did she have any close friends she might have confided in? Since we moved out to the suburbs, she'd lost touch with most of them. Now, there was this ditzy friend she'd been at drama school with.
Name?
Holly? Holly Radford. She didn't approve of me, so they used to meet up for the odd girls' night out. Suppose if Ellie was going to confide in anyone, it probably would be Holly.
At the end of the allocated hour, I left Hugo with a name in my pocket, a sinking feeling in my stomach and a need to hit the drum and monkey.
Extra large double scotch, please.
Good timing, Francis. I need to bounce some things off you.
I've had better chat-ups.
Please. I've been to see Hugo.
Can it wait till you get home?
Are you all right? You sound frazzled.
We need to talk about Joan.
Oh. I found Francis in the kitchen punching poultry.
You do know that bird's already dead.
I'm spatchcocking.
Right. What's the music?
Colonious Monk. Your mother's been playing the entire canon while she does the ironing.
I'll ask her to turn it down.
It's not the music.
Oh, well, then why are you going 15 rounds with a chicken?
It's great that Joan's on the mend and wants to help, but she's helping me to an early grave.
What's she done now?
Cross the line.
What line?
The underwear line.
I didn't know there was an underwear line.
Believe me, there is, and your mother's crossed it. I got in from school to discover my knickers had been ironed.
Oh.
It's bad enough that she handled them. Worse, it's the implicit criticism that I should iron my pants. She's completely violated the code.
There's a code as well as a line.
The mother-in-law, daughter-in-law code.
What do you want me to do?
Keep her occupied, preferably out of the house.
Is that you, Charles?
Hello.
I was ironing your carrot tops.
Not my carrot.
And I found these keys in the pocket.
Oh.
They must have gone through the wash. You should always check before you put things in the laundry.
I didn't put them in the laundry. They were in my room.
See what I mean?
Anyway, they're not my keys, Francis.
No.
They must be Hugo's.
Sure you wouldn't like some help, Francis?
No. Thank you.
Come on, Mum. Let's leave her to it.
By the time we ate, Francis's chicken was not so much tenderized as carpaccio. Sensing the atmosphere, Joan turned in by 9. Early on Saturday morning, I left a message on Holly Radford's voicemail that I was a friend of Ellie's and would like to meet for a chat. Then, I had a brainwave.
I've had an idea.
Am I going to like it?
It's a way of killing two birds with one stone.
Go on.
If I could borrow your car, I could take Joan out for a few hours.
That's one bird.
And return Hugo's clothes.
When you say return, you don't mean post them through the letterbox, do you?
Well, as I've got his keys, I could let myself in.
And get arrested for trespass. Better still, trespass in the house of a murder inquiry.
How much trouble can I get into if Joan's with me?
Frances must have really wanted some me time because she lent me her annoying little electric car on the proviso that one sniff of trouble and she'd deny all knowledge.
Are we following a funeral cortege?
When did you become a speed freak?
I'd just like to get there while I'm still alive. Where are we going, anyway?
Oh, I thought you might fancy a drive.
Taking your old mum for a spin?
Something like that.
Why do people always assume pensioners love nothing more than aimlessly driving around?
It's not aimless. I want to drop Hugo's clothes back.
I thought he was banged up.
Have you been watching reruns of The Sweeney?
In Chokey, then.
Now you sound like a character in Woodhouse.
Mm. Hugo's the one who slept on my sofa about 40 years ago.
That's right.
I remember. He was a bit of a boy even then.
How do you mean?
Right, little Casanova, flirting with me.
So it's true?
Oh, he remembered, did he?
He said how glamorous you were.
Bless him.
Bless him?
What else did he say?
That he had a bit of a crush on you.
I was in pretty good shape, if I say so myself.
And still married to Dad?
Don't worry, Charles. Nothing happened. Just a bit of fun.
Sometimes I don't think I know you at all.
So much for the great bohemian.
What does that mean?
You're just a petty bourgeois at heart. How about some music?
I did a slow drive-by to get the lay of the land and see if there was a police presence. But the house looked quiet, so I parked 50 yards up the road.
Nice place.
Hugo's made a fortune since the old days. Right, you wait here.
Can't I have a nose around?
No.
You're no fun.
Is your phone switched on?
No.
Why have a phone if it's permanently off?
Happy.
Okay. If anyone approaches the house, ring me.
The detached house was surrounded by trees, but I couldn't help feeling the entire neighbourhood watching me as I unlocked the front door. Looking for somewhere to put Hugo's clothes, I discovered all his stuff was in a spare room. Another semi-detached marriage. The master bedroom was definitely Ellie's domain, but there was a melancholia about personal trinkets without a person. By the bed, the latest Zadie Smith and an untouched Booker nominee. Nothing you couldn't hum there. An A to Z of family health told me nothing till it fell open at P. Was Ellie pregnant? Or thinking about getting pregnant? Not with Hugo, surely. In amongst a lot of paste jewellery, I found an old rosary, which, unless it was religious chic, suggested Ellie was or had been a Catholic. I didn't know what I was looking for or expecting to find, so went into the ensuite. The usual bottles, pots and jars.
Oh, damn.
The bottle I knocked off a shelf spilt its perfumed contents all over the floor. I was hurriedly mopping it up with loo paper when...
Okay, Mum, I'm coming.
You better had, because the police have just pulled over in front of the car.
What?
Second thoughts. Stay where you are. I'll buy you some time.
What do you mean? No, Mum, don't buy me time. Don't buy me anything.
I tore downstairs, let myself out of the house and sneaked out of the drive. A policeman was leaning into the open passenger door of the car.
Have you got any pain, love?
Mum, what happened?
Tell him. Tell him I don't need an ambulance.
The lady seems to be having some sort of fit.
It's just one of my turns. He knows all about them, don't you, Charles?
Yes. She gets them from time to time. They look worse than they are.
Okay, if you're sure.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, you've been very kind, but I'll just get her home.
Okay, sir. Well, you know where we are.
Yeah. Come on, Mum. Let's get you back.
That was fun. Right. I just saved your skin, so the least you can do is buy me a drink and a spot of lunch.
But a phone call from Ellie's friend Holly put lunch on a back burner. I dropped Mum home and went straight back out.
We'll have to keep it quick. I've got a show tonight.
Don't worry, I'm an actor too.
Is that how you knew Ellie? Oh, I can't believe I'm talking about her in the past tense.
Actually, I'm really a friend of Hugo's.
I see.
Yeah, he said you weren't his biggest fan.
Then he's more perceptive than I gave him credit for.
I understand why you might have taken against him.
Let's get it straight. I thought Hugo was bad for Ellie, and it looks like I was right.
You think he killed her?
What I think's irrelevant. It's what the police think that counts.
Well, they do get things wrong.
What do you want, Charles?
A picture of their marriage.
She was young, beautiful and talented. He was old, resentful and controlling. That pretty much sums it up.
How did he control her?
Apart from moving her into a pretentious house in that stifling suburb and suffocating her career at birth.
Well, she went along with it.
She thought she was in love.
Such cynicism in one so young.
Yeah, well, I've lived a bit.
I could believe it. Everything about Holly's body language said, been there, done that, bought the T-shirt, got bored with the T-shirt, swapped it for a smaller, more revealing T-shirt that said, this is me, want to make something of it.
Ellie exuded glamour and sophistication, but she was surprisingly naive, unworldly even. She saw the best in everyone. Maybe it was her Catholic background. She believed there was a divine plan and everything would work out. You know, Hugo would stop drinking, her career would take off.
Was she a practicing Catholic?
Lapsed, I think. But in my experience, religions tend to outstay their welcome. Charles, I don't mean to sound rude, but I'm going to have to kick you out if I'm going to make the half.
Of course. Thank you for your time. What's the play?
It's a new verse drama about the Eurozone crisis. We're at the Man in the Moon, Stoke Newington, if you're interested.
Well, yeah, great. If I'll definitely... Just one more thing before I go.
What?
Did Ellie ever mention an affair?
What have you heard?
Not much.
She was too discreet to say anything overt, but she did talk a lot about one man.
Did she happen to mention a name?
Actually, she did.
It wasn't a name I was expecting to hear. After the farrago of my critics' forum, I was hoping to give amateur theatricals a wide berth, but the name Holly gave me led me straight back into the lion's den.
In episode 3 of An Amateur Corpse, Charles was played by Bill Nighy, Francis by Suzanne Burden, and Joan by Geraldine McEwen. Hugo was Paul Ritter, Morris, John Glover, the detective inspector, Don Gillet, Holly, Susie Riddell, and the paramedic, Joe Sims. An Amateur Corpse was written by Jeremy Front and based on the novel by Simon Brett. The director was Sally Aidens. A Charles Paris Mystery, An Amateur Corpse, written by Jeremy Front, based on the novel by Simon Brett. Episode 4.
You're up early.
I'm going to pay Jeff Winter a visit. Coffee?
Thanks. Who's Jeff Winter?
Hugo's architect friend. Well, Ellie's.
Are you commissioning a house?
I can't afford to commission a shed.
Maybe he could do us a granny annex.
Mum will be going home soon. Her leg's much better. She went out last night.
Out where?
I don't know. She got a cab into town.
Was that wise?
She's a grown woman.
She's an elderly woman. What time did she get back?
I heard the front door about 1. Nothing since. Breakfast?
I'm going to have a shower, unless you're in a hurry to get out.
I was in no hurry to ask a man I barely knew if he'd been having an affair with my friend's recently deceased wife. But while Hugo languished in prison on a murder charge, Ellie's old friend had hinted about a possible liaison with a man called Jeff.
Francis!
Charles! It's your mum.
Oh, no. Call an ambulance. I'd better go up.
I wouldn't.
Why?
She's in the bath.
Oh, no.
With a man.
What? Alive?
Oh, very much so.
Brandy?
I'm fine.
I'm not.
It was a bit of a shock.
Well, you can say that again. I mean, were they actually...
Oddly enough, I didn't stick around to find out.
No, right, sure.
It may have been perfectly innocent.
Yeah, you popped around at 1 a.m. to clear a blocked pipe and they slipped in.
It does sound like the plot of a porno video.
Can we keep porn videos and my mother out of the same sentence?
Sorry.
Oh, here they come.
See you soon.
I'll call you. Bye.
At least we haven't got to face him.
Yeah.
Well, that was unfortunate.
Unfortunate?
I was sure I'd locked the door.
The lock has got a bit sticky.
Never mind that. What did you think you were doing?
Thinking wasn't really the point. At my age, there's plenty of time to think. I wanted to do for a change.
Oh, please.
My son, the Puritan.
What about personal safety?
I don't think I'll need the morning after pill.
Oh.
It's not safe picking up strange men.
Terry's not strange. He's a painter.
Good, he can decorate the outside of the house in lieu of last night's B&B.
He's an artist. I've known him forever. We hadn't seen each other for years till I bumped into him last night in Soho.
What were you doing in Soho?
I wanted to see how much it had changed.
They'd cleaned it up a lot.
Anyway, I was having a drink in the French house.
What were you doing in the French house?
And who should walk in? But Terry, we had a few drinks, went to a lovely little Thai place. Then he insisted on bringing me home. But it was very late, so I said he could stay the night. And, one thing led to another. I'm sorry we gave you a shock, Francis.
That's okay.
Is it?
Leave it, Charles.
Excuse me, but when you're staying under someone else's roof...
It's my roof, and don't be a hypocrite.
Obviously it wasn't planned.
Obviously.
And as I've been sleeping on the sofa bed, the sitting room was out of the question.
I suppose that's something.
Not having it off in your sitting room is something, is it?
Having it off? Are we in a 70s sitcom?
Psychically, he's never left the 70s. Deep down, he still thinks of women as chicks.
I beg your pardon.
Look at you, standing there with a face like Oliver Cromwell sucking a lemon.
Joan's right.
Clearly, I'm the only one who finds this at all bothersome, so I'm going to leave you to have your fun.
Oh, chicks.
Hello, Charles. Come in.
Thank you.
Stop it, Cherry. Get down. Come through, Charles.
Thank you. Oh, great studio.
Thanks. Once upon a time, it was going to be a nursery, but, well, things didn't work out. Sit down.
Thank you. Threepenny Opera.
Oh, yes. The next production.
Ah.
I'm directing and in it. Bites nails nervously. Rehearsal starts in January.
When do you open?
July. Yikes, only 7 months. Jeff breaks out in cold sweat. I'll turn this off.
You lot don't do things by halves. Who are you playing?
Macheath for me sins.
And Saskia?
Pirate Jenny now.
Now?
It was going to be Ellie.
Ah,
Saskia will be sorry she missed you. She's covering London Lingerie Week. It's a tough assignment, but someone's got to do it. I just hope she gets some freebies. Too much information, Jeff.
Yeah.
Actually, I've been meaning to call and apologise for my fellow thesps the other night.
It wasn't your fault.
But I told you not to pull your punches.
So did Saskia, and for that matter, Ellie.
Mm.
I'd got used to Jeff's third-person commentary, but as I mentioned Ellie, he seemed to forget his self-referential tic.
How's Hugo?
Still in prison.
Is he all right?
Not great. On the upside, he can't drink.
I suppose that's something.
Trouble is, it's come too late. You know, the night Ellie died, he was so drunk he can't honestly say whether he killed her or not.
I can't believe he did, can you?
He's a liability, but I don't believe he's a murderer. That's why I'm asking around, seeing if I can come up with anything that might help. Yesterday, I went to see an old drama school friend of Ellie's.
Oh, yes?
She thought Ellie had been seeing another man.
And was his name Jeff?
Oddly enough, it was.
I didn't kill her, you know.
I didn't suggest you did.
You were going to. And I'm afraid the police beat you to it.
They know about you and Ellie.
An affair in a local am-dram group. It wasn't going to take Sherlock to unearth the truth.
What did they say?
I'm still here, so I suppose they believed me.
Ah.
I loved Ellie, by the way, and she loved me.
So it wasn't just a backstage fling?
To begin with. I was flattered that a young woman with her looks even noticed me. Then it became more serious.
Were you going to leave Saskia?
God, no. Absolutely not.
Did she know about you and Ellie?
Saskia and I believe that men and women are perfectly able to love more than one person at a time. I hate euphemisms, but we have an understanding which allows either one of us to go with the flow.
What we used to call an open marriage.
For want of a better expression.
And that works?
It has so far. Providing both parties feel the same way and lay the ground rules from the outset.
Did Ellie know the ground rules?
What we had was fun and exhilarating. We both knew she'd eventually find a younger man, someone looking for commitment.
And you'd have been okay with that?
Absolutely.
And you don't know if Ellie had found someone younger?
I'm sure she had no shortage of offers. But no, I don't know.
Hello, Morris.
Remember that film you were so dismissive about?
The low-budget short.
Hmm. It transpires the director's fat cat dad was so racked with guilt by his disgraceful bonus, he decided to salve his conscience by investing lashings of lucre in his daughter's cinematic debut.
Saving his soul and assuring himself a place at the top table in the kingdom of heaven.
God is the one number I don't have on my phone. But I did manage to schmooze you a casting, and unless they get who they really want, I reckon the job's yours.
That was so nearly a compliment.
You want work and compliments?
I now feel very slightly guilty.
Why so?
Not telling you about Hugo's voice job.
Oh, tish tush. Water under the bridge. Let's hear no more about it. By the way, have you been paid yet?
No, it's only a small company. And as Hugo's in prison, I feel awkward hassling them for payment.
Ooh, I wouldn't. I'll happily hassle them for you, if you like. I hassle before breakfast. It's meat and drink to me. It's why I was put on this earth.
But the contract was made out directly to me.
Oh, don't worry about that.
Well, now I feel even worse. I must say, it's very decent of you, Morris.
Not at all. I'll get on to them straightway. Shove a rocket up them.
That'd be great.
No probs. Just send me a check for 10% and don't forget VAT's at 20 now. Ciao!
Francis? Anyone home? Mother?
Joan's out and I'm in here.
Ah. Any naked artists lurking in the bathroom?
It's been pleasingly dull and uneventful since this morning's little fracas.
Good. I want a drink and I want it now.
Want or need?
Yeah, don't get semantic on my ass. I'm not in the mood.
Did Jeff what's-his-name tell you to mind your own business?
Jeff Winter, and he was surprisingly unapologetic for a man who'd been cuckolding Hugo.
So, Eddie's friend was right.
Holly, yeah. Bang on the money, not that it helps Hugo. Jeff was very upfront, reckons he and his wife have an understanding.
Maybe she's not as understanding as her husband thinks.
Ah.
Jealousy's a powerful emotion, unless you buy into this open marriage stuff.
Hmm, tricky.
What is?
Tackle Saskia or go back to Holly, see if there's anything she didn't tell me. What would you do in my shoes?
You're asking me to imagine being an actor with too much time on his hands.
And a friend in prison who may not be guilty.
I'd go back and talk to Holly, see if she held anything back.
Why would she?
Because you're an actor, not a cop.
Good point.
After that, I'd have a chat with the understanding wife, find out just how understanding she really is. Now, I think I will have that drink.
Ah.
Hello?
Holly, it's Charles Paris. Sorry to bother you again.
Listen, Charles, I'm actually in my dressing room.
Is this the verse drama about the Eurozone crisis?
Yeah.
How's it going?
We're not going to break even.
Ironically.
I don't mean to be rude, Charles, but I'm on stage in 5 minutes.
Absolutely, sorry. I realise there's no reason for you to tell me anything about Ellie you don't want to.
What else do you want to know?
Well, that's the thing. I don't really know. Holly? Are you still there?
Okay. If she was still alive, I wouldn't dream of mentioning this, but I suppose it doesn't matter now. Ellie wasn't religious. On the other hand, what is it the Jesuits say? Give me the child...
Give me the child till he's seven and I'll show you the man.
Or in this case, woman. When we were students, Ellie and I used to have these late-nighters. All cheap wine and big thoughts.
That's what students are for. After two bottles of Blue Nun, I used to turn into Wittgenstein.
Oh, I remember one night we got onto abortion, and I was really surprised how pro-life she was. I mean, I was just taking a position, but Ellie was very hot under the collar, and she got really angry when I put it down to her Catholic upbringing. Anyway, recently we had lunch, and I was a bit edgy when the subject came up again, but her attitude was very different. She asked if I'd ever had a termination, but she wasn't judgmental, more inquiring.
You think she was pregnant?
She didn't say, and I didn't ask. I just sensed a change in attitude. Sorry, Charles, I've really got to go.
And then I remembered the rosary in the jewellery drawer. But it begged a question, and the keeper of the answer was banged up.
Oh, it's good to see you, Charlie.
How's it going?
Oh, they've discovered I'm a man of letters.
You run a voiceover company.
Yeah, well, by their standards, I'm Marcel Proust now. Become a bit of a favourite with some of the lads.
Is that a good thing?
Well, rather have them as my friends.
Yeah, I suppose so. Any word on the trial?
Not yet. Well, a solicitor puts a brave face on things. Some days I feel quite optimistic. And then I lie awake thinking about Ellie and what happened and... me dying would bring her back.
Don't talk like that, Hugo. Can I ask you something about Ellie?
Oh, you can ask, but my memory is so shot.
How Catholic was she?
Well, she didn't practice. Mind you know what they say, give me the child till he's seven.
It was the second time I'd heard that in the past 24 hours.
One more thing, it's rather personal.
Yeah, go on.
Was she pregnant?
Not that I knew. But as we're putting it all out there, let me tell you, I was drinking so much the past few months, our sex life was practically non-existent. So, if you think she was pregnant...
Well, like I say, Hugo, I'm just trying to make sense of things.
Why are you looking at lingerie online?
I'm not.
You very much are.
Well, no, I've arranged to meet Saskia.
And you thought you'd buy her a present to butter her up. Good call. I gave her the gold busting.
She's covering London Lingerie Week.
The lingerie isn't covering very much.
I think that's the idea of lingerie.
You've become quite an expert.
I'm a man. It's genetic. Anyway, I'm looking up the address of a club called Casbah Nights.
What's this?
Charles looking at lingerie.
I used to have something like that in Coral.
I can't do pinks.
Used to drive your father into a frenzy.
Oh, please.
Amazing what a piece of silk can do to a man.
That's it. I'm off.
Don't be a prig. How do you think you got here?
The Northern Line.
You were not conceived on the Northern Line.
Bye-bye, ladies. See you later.
Enjoy the knickers.
The venue was a burlesque club. Ironically, a 5-minute walk from Hugo's Soho office. After fighting my way through a sneer of fashionistas, I spotted Saskia, phone in one hand, champagne flute in the other.
Charles! Pity, you've just missed the men's collection.
Men's lingerie?
Welcome to the 21st century, Charles.
Well, most of my underwear's from the 20th, and I'm resolutely M&S.
We'll have to see if we can't ease you into something on trend.
Well, I'm fine, thanks.
Your phone call was very mysterious. What's it all about, I thought? What can the glamorous Charles Paris want with little old me?
Well, you're thinking of another Charles Paris.
You're the only one I've been thinking about.
I was getting the feeling that Jeff and Saskia's marriage was as open as he'd suggested.
I gather you went to see Jeff.
I've been talking to a lot of Ellie and Hugo's friends.
Trying to get Hugo off the hook.
Do you think he killed Ellie?
The man's a mess. I wouldn't put anything past him.
Even murder?
Not premeditated.
But we've all seen how volatile he is when he's had a skinful. He tried to punch you. And I gather you know about Ellie and Jeff.
Yes. I was surprised you were okay with it.
The most destructive forces in a marriage are secrets and lies.
Too much honesty can be pretty dangerous.
Only if it's offensive or hurtful. We could check into a hotel now and Jeff would be fine about it.
We were not going to test her proposition. Apart from anything, predatory women are not my type. You think any marriage can work along those lines?
I imagine it's easier if you don't have children. But I'll never know.
Jeff told me his home office was originally going to be a nursery.
Yes, well, things didn't work out. Man proposes, biology disposes.
But what if things had worked out between Jeff and Ellie? Would Saskia have been blithely accepting? Or would she have wanted to see her rival dead?
I'll spare you the gory details of failed IVF. But after years of exploratory plumbing work, we sort of lost impetus.
I'm sorry.
Oh. It's Jeff I feel sorry for. He's too sweet to go on about it, but he was keener than he makes out. And that's why I could never begrudge him his little flings. And he wouldn't begrudge mine. Speaking of which, if we're not going to sleep together, the least you can do is buy me a drink.
E vorrei un'altra bottiglia di San Gimignano, per favore.
Naturalmente, signora.
Mm.
Where did that come from?
You pick things up.
Like artists.
Charles, I told you, Terry's an old friend. If you're going to be like this all evening...
Okay, I'm sorry.
It's extremely generous of Joan to take us out for dinner.
Well, it's my way of saying thank you. My leg's a lot better and I can't rely on you two forever, so I think it's time I went home.
Good for you.
Charles, are you sure you're up to it, Joan?
Of course she is.
I'll be fine. Terry's offered to give me a hand.
Oh, that's nice.
And that way, we don't have to worry about being caught in flagrante delicto.
Oh.
Oh, you're so easy to wind up. For a man of the world, you can be remarkably hidebound by bourgeois convention.
Said the Telegraph reading boho.
Oh, you've got everybody labelled, haven't you?
Let's keep it down, boys and girls.
Men are this, women are that, old people are something else.
That's not true.
When a woman gets her senior citizen's rail card, they don't reissue her maidenhead.
Oh, God.
Il suo vino, signora.
No, grazie. Lasci pure la bottiglia. Ci pensiamo noi.
Va bene.
He's rather gorgeous, don't you think, Francis? A touch of Caravaggio about the lips.
Pour the wine, Charles.
Still playing detective, are you?
I'm just trying to help an old friend.
Mm. And what have you discovered so far?
That Ellie was a lapsed Catholic having an affair with Jeff, whose wife didn't mind because they had an open marriage.
That's balls, for starters.
Did you even find out if Ellie was pregnant?
No, but Saskia confirmed what Jeff had said about them trying for a family.
Oh, there you are. The wife did it. End of case.
What if Ellie wasn't pregnant?
She doesn't need to have been. She might have told Jeff she was to provoke some action. Or she might have thought she was pregnant. Either way, if he told his barren wife that he'd got his mistress up the duff...
I don't think we say barren anymore.
It would be enough to tip the woman over the edge. She sees red and kills the fertile object of his desire.
There's certainly a ring of Greek tragedy about it.
That's not a bad theory.
Thank you.
Except Jeff told me he'd never leave Saskia.
A man says he'd never leave his wife... then leaves his wife. What do you think, Francis?
I've never heard anything so preposterous.
Okay, point taken.
Mm-hmm. Mark my words, the wife did it. If I'm right, the next dinner's on you.
Mm.
In fact, you owe me one after I saved you from getting arrested at Hugo's house.
What?
Where's my whitebait? Are they waiting for the trawler to come in?
The next morning brought a mild hangover, which was quickly cured by the postman.
Yes.
Are you all right?
I am now. The fee's come through from Hugo's Sport and Dry commercial. Look.
Are you sure the decimal point's in the right place?
Looks like the milky bars are on me.
Hello? Hugo from prison.
Hugo.
Yeah, after you left, I started stewing on what you said.
Well, I didn't mean to upset you.
No, you were only trying to help. Anyway, I spoke to my lawyer. The post-mortem said Ellie wasn't pregnant. She had been, but she lost it.
Oh, I don't know what to say. I'm so sorry.
Well, it's not your fault she had an affair. God, if I'd been married to me, I'd have bailed out long ago.
Hugo's words were still in my head as I waited in Jeff and Saskia's porch.
Shut up, Sherry!
Charles! What a lovely surprise! Come through. Were you just in the area?
Actually, I came to see you.
Did you? I'm flattered, although I think you should know Jeff's here.
She didn't need to tell me. Lottie Lenya's dulcet tones announced that he was in the house.
The show's taking up so much of his time, I'm going to need a diversion. I think you might be it.
Well, I'm not sure I can offer the kind of diversion you're after.
I'll be the judge of that.
You'll have your work cut out rehearsing Pirate Jenny.
I've already learnt my lines. Want to test me?
I hear they were going to be Ellie's lines.
Don't think me rude, Charles, but if you're not here for recreation...
My friend is being charged with the murder of his wife, and I think he's innocent.
Oh, please tell me you don't think I murdered Ellie for a part in a show.
No, I think you murdered her because she was pregnant.
What? Excuse me a minute. Jeff!
Hello?
Down here! Now!
What's the matter? Oh. Charles? Sass, what's wrong?
Was Ellie pregnant?
You bastard.
He's not the bastard, you bastard!
Sticking your snout in.
Why didn't you tell me?
I didn't want to upset you.
Well, that worked.
I was scared you'd think I was going to leave you.
While a marriage fractured before my eyes, my brain scampered round its wheel, trying to catch up.
You mean you weren't going to leave me?
Never. You know that, Sass.
Don't sass me.
She wanted me to, but I said it wasn't going to happen. I even tried to get her to have an abortion.
You did what? After everything we went through...
But it wasn't us. It was her. She was going to ruin everything. Anyway, she refused.
Give me the child till she's seven.
What?
Sorry. Sorry.
She was sick of Hugo. She wanted to start over with me and her baby. When I said no, she threatened me, said if I didn't tell you, she would. I kept saying I'd never leave you for her or her baby.
What do you mean, her baby? It wasn't an immaculate conception.
I didn't mean to hurt her, but she could be a piece of work. Everyone saw the sweet-natured angel, but she had this way of pushing me.
What are you saying?
It was an accident.
Oh, no.
The night I went over, she was in a foul mood with Hugo. He was unconscious, smashed out of his mind. She was like a banshee, all tears and rage, kept yelling at me. I hope you're happy now. I didn't know what was happening. She went out to get some logs for the fire. I followed, but every time I tried to speak, she just bit my head off, shouting, screaming, swearing.
I don't believe what I'm hearing.
I didn't mean to. I just lost it, grabbed her. She fell, banged her head.
Oh, my God.
You could have called an ambulance.
Jeff?
But then it wouldn't have been over, would it? You saw a way out, so you pushed her under the pool cover and left Hugo to take the blame.
I'm so sorry.
Keep away from me, you monster!
The irony is, she wasn't pregnant.
What?
She had been, but she'd lost the baby.
Why didn't she tell me?
Was it your idea to go over that night?
No. She phoned me. She had to talk to me right then, right that bloody minute. She was going to tell me. What have I done? What have I done?
If anything good came of Ellie's death, it was Hugo's decision to get himself clean. So he checked out of prison and straight into rehab. Joan had been wrong about Saskia, but I still owed her a dinner for saving my skin.
Call yourself a habitué of Soho? I can't believe you've never eaten here. When I was modelling, we used to come here all the time.
Modelling what?
Me. St. Martin's School of Art was round the corner.
You were a life model?
Before you came along and everything headed south.
Does that mean that there are paintings of you?
There must be hundreds. My one regret is that I never persuaded Francis to paint me.
Francis doesn't paint.
Bacon.
You knew Francis Bacon?
Mm. You couldn't drink at the colony room and not know him.
Whoa, hang on. Are you the real Joan Paris, or is there a giant pod in a basement somewhere?
Is your world rocking, Charles? Did you think you'd invented sex, drugs and rebellion? I infuriated my parents long before you tried to infuriate me and your father.
But you and Dad and me growing up in the suburbs, it was straight out of Enid Blyton.
She used to play nude tennis.
Just William, then. And please, don't tell me you and Dad used to play nude tennis.
Your father was a thoroughly respectable man. That's probably why we attracted each other. I was getting bored with poets, so a clean-shaven man with a well-cut suit and a conventional job was strangely exotic.
This is messing with my head.
I know, dear. It's so annoying to have one's prejudices unconfirmed.
You wore floral dresses and hats and long gloves.
By the time you arrived, I decided to embrace bourgeois life. What did Oscar say? All women become like their mothers. That is their tragedy.
No man does. That is his.
Mm. He was a clever boy. But he got that one wrong, didn't he?
I suppose he did.
A few days later, I helped move Joan back into her own house. And a few days after that, Terry the painter moved in with her. Life with Francis was back to normal. Well, normal for us. And with Christmas fast approaching, I was finally getting into the festive spirit.
Ah. One for you.
Ah.
And this big one's addressed to both of us.
Ah. At last, Morris has sent me the script for the short film.
I did what all actors do. Flicked through to see how many pages featured my character.
Blimey, it's in 3D.
There's a note with a big one. Oh. Dear Francis and Charles, thank you so much for putting me up and putting up with me. Here's something to remind you of your loving mother. From Joan and Terry. Mm. Joint presents.
Bloody Morris.
What?
I've got a nude scene.
What a waste of 3D.
Oh, ha bloody ha.
Come on, help me open this.
A painting.
It must be one of Terry's. We'll have to find somewhere to hang it. Ooh!
What? Come on, turn it round. Oh. Oh!
I'm thinking maybe not in the dining room. Oh, look, you've both got the same mould.
On the other hand, there is a touch of Stanley Spencer about this. I wonder if he'd do us in a double portrait. We could do prints and send them out at Christmas.
I'm not getting naked for no one.
You could wear Christmas stockings.
I think Santa's little helper is getting carried away.
Come upstairs and I'll put on my elf costume. We can practice poses.
I've got a much better idea.
Really?
Yeah.
35 cards waiting for your signature.
So fill your hearts with the Christmas cheer, till Santa Claus comes back.
In episode 4 of An Amateur Corpse, Charles was played by Bill Nighy, Francis by Suzanne Burden, and Joan by Geraldine McEwen. Jeff was Patrick Brennan, Hugo, Paul Ritter, Morris, John Glover, Holly, Susie Riddell, and Saskia, Christine Absalom. An Amateur Corpse was written by Jeremy Front and based on the novel by Simon Brett. The director was Sally Avens.